First off, let me join others in congratulating you for being able to join this august institution. The Academy Initiative on the Global Nuclear Future has brought together Academy members from many academic disciplines and from professions, along with significant Washington and international policymakers, to address a single but very complicated question. Will the expected spread of nuclear power around the world also create the further spread of nuclear weapons? The project has been both a research project and a project of policy impact activities. The research has resulted in two special issues of Daedalus, published last year, a set of occasional papers, and the policy impact activity has included sets of workshops and meetings and briefings at the National Security Council staff, on Capitol Hill, and with international scholars and nuclear industry officials in the Middle East and in November in Southeast Asia. I only have a few minutes, and on the principle that a picture is worth a thousand words, I'm going to try to have many words done quickly by showing you a bit of the research and illustrations of what we've been doing. So if we go to the next slide, what we have here is a simple explanation of what states have nuclear power today, the black listed states and the aspiring states. And at one of our meetings, as we were scoping out this project, it was noted that it's interesting to look at the geographic spread of countries that have asked the IAEA for assistance. It would be interesting to look at their economic standing to get a sense of how likely it is that they will actually achieve their objectives. But it was pointed out, shouldn't we also look at their political conditions, the characteristics that will influence how safely and or securely they will be able to operate nuclear facilities? So the next slide illustrates that by looking at the countries that were listed in the earlier chart and looking at their averages in terms of their control of corruption, seeing that existing states with nuclear power have higher abilities to control corruption than do the aspiring nuclear states. Political stability, being defined by the World Bank as the likelihood of insurrections or other serious violent uprisings within a state. Government effectiveness, regulatory quality, and democracy versus autocracy. On all of these issues, the aspiring states look quite different, giving this group of scholars a sense of the challenge that we will face if nuclear power spreads to make sure to decrease the likelihood that it will have security problems attached to it. The democracy autocracy score is also interesting in another way. If I could go to the next chart. This is very complicated, like reading a doctor's chart, so let me very quickly try to explain what this is. There are many countries that have tried to get nuclear weapons, have started nuclear weapons programs, but have ended them for a variety of different reasons. And scholars in the past looking at this have noted, well, democracies and non-democracies, they both have nuclear weapons. If you look at the number of countries who have tried to get nuclear weapons, democracies and non-democracies have started nuclear weapons programs and have ended them. So the regime type, whether a country's democratic or not, doesn't seem to be all that important. Wrong. What this chart tries to demonstrate is using that black dot, which is when did the country join the NPT, the Non-Proliferation Treaty, stating that they would not seek or acquire nuclear weapons. And you'll note that all democracies marked in blue that had nuclear weapons programs ended them and then joined the NPT and have not cheated on their commitment not to seek or acquire, have not restarted their programs. All the countries that have cheated have signed the treaty and then had a secret nuclear weapons program afterwards were non-democratic. Why that is, we don't have a full understanding of the influences of democratic polity on keeping international agreements, although this, I think, is a very interesting finding that we want to explore in more detail moving forward. So the last slide, please. Will the spread of nuclear weapons lead to the spread, will the spread of nuclear power lead to the spread of nuclear weapons? We have a clear, simple answer to that complex answer, complex question. It depends. It depends on the political institutions that are created and sustained and either broken or improved upon over time. So we need political scientists thinking about these issues. And here we have a picture of my colleague Steve Miller meeting in an American Academy-sponsored session on the edges of the Non-Proliferation Treaty Review Conference in New York in May, where we gathered together three of the past presidents of the NPT Review Conference, along with the current president shown in the picture with Steve, to talk about how to improve the treaty and what kinds of mechanisms could lead, in a political sense, to improve the institution and the overall proliferation, non-proliferation regime. But it also depends on the technology. What will the next generation of nuclear power plants look like? What will improved safeguards and safety mechanisms look like from a technological perspective? And how will we ensure that the best technologies are exported and some of the ones that are more dangerous are not exported? Here we have Bob Rosner at Argonne showing some of his technological bona fides. And I think I've teed up my two colleagues who will now talk about both the politics and the technology of this problem. Steve.
Well, thank you, Scott. Let me provide some additional texture to the overview that Scott has so well provided. We live in a world that has a certain set of nuclear attributes, and the big punchline is that world is changing. It's disappearing. We're heading into a different world. And the broad question we're asking is, how will we be able to live safely and fruitfully in that new world? Or if you're more cynical, will we be able to live safely in that world? And to summarize with a little more detail the big changes that we're talking about, in today's world, we live on a planet where there are 438 nuclear power reactors distributed across about 30 countries. About half of that nuclear capability is found in three countries, the United States, France, and Japan. All 30 of the existing nuclear power states, as we call them, tend to be captured by NATO plus Russia plus Japan plus China. That's the overwhelming majority. In the last several years, 60 additional countries, that's 60, have approached the International Atomic Energy Agency and expressed an interest in pursuing nuclear power. So if all those dreams came true, we would triple the number of nuclear power states. Now, this is a very long timeline phenomenon, so we're talking about where we're going to end up three, four decades from now. But that will be a very different world. And if the most extravagant visions presently forecast were to come true, in about 30 years, we would be living in a world that had 500 or 600 additional nuclear reactors spread across dozens of additional countries, many of which presently have no nuclear technology and very little capacity for handling nuclear technology. So what we're seeing is a very dramatic change for a variety of obvious reasons we don't have time to go into, having to do with climate change, energy security concerns, changing economics of energy. We're seeing a changing pattern in the demand for nuclear power.